Brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I'm your host, Karim Abu Zaid, and I feel so blessed to be with you during the best days of the year, the blessed days of the Hijjah, brothers and sisters in Islam. Another season of obedience that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows upon this ummah. The ummah just left a season of obedience during the month of Ramadan, in which we were given chances for forgiveness. If you fasted Ramadan out of iman, imanan wa ihtisaba, out of ihtisab, believing and wanting the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will forgive your previous sins. If you have prayed qiyam during Ramadan, again, out of belief and wanting the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will forgive all your previous sins. Actually, just one night, subhanallah, one night during the last night of Ramadan, قال صلى الله عليه وسلم من قام ليلة القدر إيمانا واحتسابا, whosoever stands in qiyam, in ibadah, in obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during the night of al-Qadr, out of iman, out of belief, wanting the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will forgive his previous sins. Here is the ummah, brothers and sisters in Islam, just got done with these chances to earn forgiveness and to bring themselves back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And here is the ummah is receiving another season of obedience. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves this ummah. Wallahi, Allah does. Ya ikhwa, look at this beautiful verse that a lot of us read. And look how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commented about this verse in a hadith in Musnad al-Imam Ahmad, hadith Bahz ibn Hakim an abihi an jaddi. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Antum mufuna sab'ina umma. Your number in the numbers of nations before you, my followers, is the number 70. That means before us, there were 69 nations. We are number 70. Look what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Antum khayruha. You are the best. Wa akramuha. And the most noble, or the noblest in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And subhanallah, here is the ummah is about to receive the best days of the year. The best days of the year. Yes, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned this in a straightforward statement in a hadith في مسند الإمام البزار من حديث جابر بن عبد الله رضي الله عنهما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, أفضل أيام الدنيا, وفي رواية أعظم أيام الدنيا, وفي رواية خير أيام الدنيا. The best days of the year, أيام العشر, is the days, the 10 days of the Hijjah. Brothers and sisters in Islam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam actually mentioned regarding the deeds, the righteous deeds that are done during the 10 days of the Hijjah in a hadith narrated by Abdullah ibn Abbas, and the hadith is compiled fi Sahih al-Bukhari, Sunan Abi Dawood, wa Musnad Ahmad, the wording of Ibn Umar radiyallahu anhuma. Look what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said about these days. ما من أيام العمل الصالح فيها خي أحب إلى الله من تلك الأيام. There is no other days out of the year in which the righteous deeds which are performed are more beloved to Allah than the deeds that you do during the 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. A man asked, or a companion asked, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulallah, wala al-jihad fi sabilillah, not even going to fight in the cause of Allah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, wala al-jihad fi sabilillah, not even fighting in the cause of Allah, except this case. Rajulun, a man, kharaja bi nafsihi wa malih, ولم يعد بشيء منهما. A man who went out with himself, with offering himself, offering his soul, and also with his wealth, and he came back with none. Brothers and sisters in Islam, a lot of the Muslims are unaware of the virtues, the merits, the importance of these days. And here is the issue. A lot of the Muslims, they think that these days have to do with Hajj, being in Mecca, meaning these days are special, are blessed only for those who go to Hajj. And this is absolutely incorrect, brothers and sisters in Islam. Why? Because we know that Hajj is the only pillar in Islam. Yani, the pillar in Islam, to begin with, the initial prescription of that pillar, that you must be able to. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا. It is mandatory upon الناس here, people, meaning the Muslims, to perform Hajj, to go to the house of Allah in Mecca, if they are able to. And we know the ability here means physical ability and financial ability. And we know that a lot of Muslims have physical disability. And we know that a lot of Muslims have financial disability. That means a lot of Muslims will not be able to make it to Mecca. Yes, we know also that Hajj, brothers and sisters in Islam, is a pillar that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prescribed upon every Muslim once in a lifetime. Yes, hadith Abi Huraira radiyallahu anhu, wal hadith fi sahih al-imam Muslim. Abu Huraira says, one day the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam stood up and he delivered a khutbah. Khatabana Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam dhata yawmin faqal. And he said in his sermon, Ya ayyuhan nas, O people, O Muslims, Inna Allah qad farada alaykum al-hajj fahujju. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prescribed Hajj upon you. So go and perform Hajj. The Prophet sallallahu, a companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in one of the wording, not in Sahih Muslim, the narrator named him Al-Aqra' ibn Habis, that a companion of the Prophet sallallahu, whose name is Al-Aqra' ibn Habis radiyallahu anhu, he stood up and he asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَكُلَّ عَامٍ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, must we do this every single year, O Messenger of Allah? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not answer him. Then the same companion repeated the question twice, the second time, أَكُلَّ عَامٍ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, must we do this? Must we go and perform Hajj every single year, O Messenger of Allah? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not answer him. Then the same companion repeated the question for the third time. أَكُلَّ عَامٍ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, every year, O Messenger of Allah? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not answer him at this time with a very serious tone, telling him, لو قلت نعم لوجبت ولما استطعتم. If I would have said yes, if I would say yes, you have to perform Hajj every single year, you're gonna have to do it and you're gonna be unable to perform it. Can you imagine? Every single year, 1.4 billion Muslims have to go and perform Hajj in Mecca. Can you imagine this? If Hajj is mandatory upon you every single year, imagine this, like the Salah. You have to pray five times. You have no choice. You have to go every year to Mecca. No, it is mandatory upon every Muslim once in a lifetime. And a lot of the Muslims are unable physically, are unable financially to perform it. Does this mean, brothers and sisters in Islam, that that mass of Muslims, the huge, that number of Muslims who are not in Mecca are deprived from the virtues and the merits and the significance of the 10 days of the Hijjah? Absolutely not. Yes, brothers and sisters in Islam, if you go and perform Hajj, you're going to end up to be in the best place at the best time. Hajj is the best act of worship that you can do during these 10 days. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam named Mecca, which hosts the house of Allah, to be the most beloved piece of earth to Allah. Wal hadith fi sunan al-Tirmidhi. This is not my talk. هذا قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. He made that statement in his way out, migrating to Medina. By Allah, you are the most beloved piece of earth to Allah and to me. And has it been for your people expelling me, I would not have left you. So if you go and perform Hajj, yes, and Umrah, yes, during the 10 days of the Hijjah, you're going to end up in the best place at the best time of the year. But what about those brothers and sisters in Islam who are unable to? What about those brothers and sisters in Islam who did perform Hajj already? Are they deprived from the merits and the virtues of these 10 days of the Hijjah? Absolutely not. We'll take a short break and we'll come back, inshallah, explaining this to the Ummah, to the brothers and sisters in Islam who did not make it this year to Hajj, that there are deeds that you can do which will earn you a lot of reward during the 10 days of the Hijjah, inshallah. Let's take a short break and come back, carry on talking about the blessed days of the Hijjah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, welcome back to the best days of the year, to the blessed days of the Hijjah. This is the name of the series. We're going to talk about these days which are a grant from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the Ummah to make up again with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers and sisters in Islam, like I said before the break, that the best deed that you can do during the 10 days of the Hijjah is to go and perform Hajj. And inshallah, in the coming episodes, we will talk to those who are in Hajj. They are probably going to be able to watch us in their hotels and bring about the importance of that pillar and how wonderful of a chance they have that they are in the best place in the face of this earth at the best time of the year. But that segment, I really want to talk to my brothers and sisters in Islam who are not in Hajj. Because these days, brothers and sisters in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the tongue of His Messenger, has prescribed certain deeds that will tie you with those who are in Hajj, and at the same time you earn rewards. Here is the first deed. Listen to this. Hadith fi Sahih Muslim, Hadith Umm Salama radiyallahu anha, Umm al-Mu'mineen. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam says, إِذَا رَأَيْتُمْ هِلَالَ ذِي الْحِجَّةِ. If you see the crescent, the moon, for ذِي الْحِجَّةِ, وَأَرَادَ أَحَدُكُمْ أَن يُضَحِّي, and one of you is planning to offer قُرْبَانِ, a sacrifice, أُضُحِيَّةِ, on the 10th, this sacrifice is to be offered on the day of Eid, which is the 10th day of the Hijjah, which is the day of Nahr. إِنَّ أَعْطَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرِ فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ وَانْحَرْ. Indeed, O Muhammad, we have granted you, bestowed upon you al-Kawthar, which is a river in Jannah, which will have a bond, an extension of that river on the day of resurrection, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be given his followers a drink of water. Now, pray Salatul Eid and then offer the sacrifice. So if you are not on Hajj, if you did not go to Hajj, and inshallah, you're going to offer a sacrifice, a qurbani, then you must make sure that you refrain. Huh. The Prophet ﷺ, again, he said, إِذَا أَرَادَ أَحَدُكُمْ أَنْ يُضَحِّي إِذَا رَأَيْتُمْ هِلَالَ ذِي الْحِجَّةِ إِذَا رَأَيْتُمْ هِلَالَ ذِي الْحِجَّةِ وَأَرَادَ أَحَدُكُمْ أَنْ يُضَحِّي فَلْيُمْسِكْ عَنْ شَعْرِهِ وَأَظَافِرِهِ. Let that person who will offer a qurbani refrain from taking any of the hair or any of the nails. That would mean no shaving, no shaving of the head, no shortening of the hair. Of course, we should not be shaving our beard to begin with, even not during the 10 days of the Hijjah. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم اعفوا اللحى وقصوا الشارب. Shorten your mustache and let your beards grow. During the 10 days of the Hijjah, if you're going to offer a sacrifice, a qurbani, that is the famous name in the Ummah now, for that, on the 10th day of the Hijjah, then refrain from cutting your nails and also refrain from taking any of your hair. طيب, look at this, brothers and sisters in Islam. Subhanallah, this act is for those who are not in Hajj. This act is very similar to those who are in Hajj too. Subhanallah, those who go to Hajj, when they enter into the state of Ihram, which when they become in a state of Ihram, when they reach the boundary, one of the boundaries around Mecca, then they say, Allahumma labbayka umrah, or Allahumma labbayka hajjah. One of the restrictions, one of the things that they cannot do as long as they are in that state of Ihram, they cannot cut their nails, they cannot take any of their hair. You see, here is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is linking, tying the shara through the deen, yani, through the religion, between those who are in Hajj and those who are not in Hajj. Similar deeds, similar acts, brothers and sisters in Islam. طيب, look at this. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, brothers and sisters in Islam, in a hadith that I just quoted right before the break, but the wording of Ibn Umar, and the wording of Ibn Umar radiyallahu anhuma, is in the Musnad, Musnad al-Imam Ahmad rahimahullah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also made the similar statement that there are no other deeds performed on other days, or the deeds which are performed on the 10 days of the Hijjah are more beloved to Allah than the deeds which are performed in other days throughout the year. Yani, any righteous deed that you do during the 10 days of the Hijjah is more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than these deeds that are performed in days other than the 10 days of the Hijjah. ما من أيام العمل الصالح فيها أحب إلى الله من تلك الأيام يعني العشرة. Look at this now. Here is the addition in the wording of Imam Ahmad with Ibn Umar. فأكثروا فيهن من التهليل والتحميد والتكبير. You need to say a lot of takbir. You need to say a lot of tahmid. Tahmid is alhamdulillah. Takbir is Allahu Akbar. Tahleel is La ilaha illallah. And you know that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu, the companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who copied the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his hadi and his sunnah, he explained this to us. He said, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. La ilaha illallah. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Walillahil hamd. We're supposed to say this during the 10 days of the Hijjah. And brothers and sisters in Islam, this is an abandoned sunnah by a lot of Muslims. A lot of Muslims are unaware that during the first 10 days of the Hijjah, these blessed days that we're talking about, we're supposed to utter the remembrance of Allah, التهليل والتحميد والتكبير، صيغة ابن مسعود: الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله، الله أكبر الله أكبر، ولله الحمد. أن سبحان الله، الإمام البخاري رحمه الله compiled in his صحيح that عبد الله بن عمر، and we know how عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله عنهما used to be in love with the sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم، and أبو هريرة، and we know also how much أبو هريرة رضي الله عنه loved the sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. They used to go to the market in Medina during the 10 days of the Hijjah, and they used to utter these takbirat: الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله، الله أكبر الله أكبر، ولله الحمد، with a loud voice to remind the people who are in the market selling and buying to utter these takbirat as well. Here is the important piece, brothers and sisters in Islam. This is for the people who are not in Hajj, who did not make it. What about the people who are in Hajj? Look how our beautiful religion, our beautiful deen, tied those who are in Hajj with those who are not in Hajj. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam told us that as soon as you enter into the state of ihram at the miqat, as soon as you say Allahumma labbayka umrah or Allahumma labbayka hajjah, you're supposed to utter the talbiyah بصوت مرتفع. You're supposed to say لبيك اللهم لبيك، لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك، إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك لا شريك لك. So look, those who are in Hajj are uttering the dhikr with a loud voice. But again, I want to warn my brothers and sisters in Islam, we should not do it in congregation. It should be done individually. The congregation dhikr is a bid'ah, but you do it individually with a loud voice. For here is the people who are in Hajj are mentioning the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like Ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma explained that beautiful verse in Surah Al-Hajj, وَيَذْكُرُ اللَّهَ فِي أَيَّامٍ مَعْلُومَاتٍ, meaning that they mention the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during the 10 days of the Hijjah. Those who are in Hajj are doing this, and those who are not in Hajj are doing this. Very quickly, because I'm about to be done. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كما في سنن أبي داود حديث عبد الله عبد الرحمن بن يعمر رضي الله عنه, he said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم sent a caller to call amongst those who are in Hajj on the day of Arafah. الحج عرفة, الحج عرفة, حج is عرفة. The greatest pillar of Hajj is Arafah. This is the day, brothers and sisters in Islam, on which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala frees a lot of people from the hellfire. كما روت عائشة رضي الله عنها في صحيح مسلم قالت ما من قال صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, ما من يوم أكثر أن يعتق فيه عبدا من النار من يوم عرفة. There is no other day on which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will free a lot of necks from the hellfire than the day of Arafah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends and he forgives those who are standing in the mountain of Arafah. Look, you earn your forgiveness. You earn that birth certificate, that new beginning with Allah if you are in Arafah. What about if you are not in Arafah? Are you deprived? Absolutely not. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم فيما أخرج مسلم حديث أبي قتادة رضي الله عنه, أبو قتادة asked the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, O messenger of Allah, what do you say about fasting the day of Arafah? The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, it expiates the previous year and the coming year. You see, here is our religion includes, all inclusive for those who are not in Hajj and those who are in Hajj. Brothers and sisters in Islam, do not miss the next episode of the blessed days of the Hijjah. We will shed more light on some of the deeds that can be done during these 10 days of the Hijjah for those who are not in Hajj. And then inshallah, we're going to address those who are in Hajj as they are gearing up for the 8th of the Hijjah inshallah. Till the next episode of the blessed days of the Hijjah, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.